Virgin going out this tournament. That'd be a sad end to their run. I wouldn't want to go out in home soil first game, would they?
Dire haven't won a game?
Back. Yeah.
That'd be a rough weekend.
It would.
What's that like, Jacob? Going out in the first round.
I don't know. Ask Winter.
Hey.
He hasn't even got you.
Okay. We are into game number two's draft and some familiar bands. We saw three of those? Three of the four bans in the first game?
Yeah, Luna got upgraded this time into a ban territory. And I kind of agree with that. Just because Luna's such a powerful carry, it works without the Shadow Demon. It just like ticks all your boxes. It's like somewhat of a fighting core. It pushes out waves pretty well. It gives you high ground capabilities. And it's also like a hard hero for the offlaner to deal with. Like, the Nyx Assassin was miserable in the laning phase, not just because, like, they had a Dazzle. That's not a support that you feel, like, particularly scared of, but the added power of the Luna in lane causes you a lot of issues.
Execrations turn so first pick junk this time around.
Generally banned out, and that was the change as far as the bans go, so nice bit of flexibility where you can play that either in the mid or the safe lane, and is one of the few mid laners that is pretty immune to most ganking squads.
That does open up for the Mirana Shadow Demon combo if they want to go for it. Execration. Reserve then again, they are a team that feels very comfortable playing the Sand King.
What about Batrider?
Just haven't seen it a lot.
Yeah.
And one game, I think.
Also, I don't think there's a reason for rushing it right now. I mean, obviously the Legion is banned, so that's a thing, but there's still a Shadow Demon in the pool.
So you're saying there's so many valuable offlaners out there that it doesn't necessarily make sense forcing the offlane pick?
Yeah. I think so. I think there's so much that you can play on the offlane that you don't want to just... I mean, Bat is all around always a good hero, but... Okay.
There's an early
Axe is good against Juggernaut.
Oh, yeah.
It really is.
You've got the big increase in armor to be able to deal with Omni Slash, and you've also got a disable that goes through the spin. Very value.
Yeah, it's always so frustrating playing against those jugs that just like creep skip your way, Blade Fury TP out, and you have nothing to cancel the Blade Fury TP.
Yeah.
5 seconds remaining.
It's also like one of those openings. Like you see that if you're WG Union, you're just like, what are they doing? Like, are they going for another 5-man push? Like, you don't know. This Axe is just kind of one of those curveball picks that doesn't really. It catches you by surprise, but also doesn't reveal like exactly how Execration is looking to play this game.
I think both Rubick or Mirana would be a good pickup right now.
I also think Sphere Breaker is pretty good in this patch because of the natural tankiness he provides, and I think in part that that hero is pretty good versus just an opening of Juggernaut. I think that like tankier supports are pretty value. Even Rubick has value because of the magic armor that he brings, even if he himself is not a tankier hero.
100% win rate right now as well.
And stealing jobs things is not a bad idea. Mm.
Rubick would also keep at bay the potential sanking pickup for WG Unity.
Winter Wyvern.
Wyvern? Well,
are they doing the Wyvern Axe like?
And we're going to a game three.
You don't like this? I mean,
Jacob's already disgusted after two picks.
This is an odd opening.
I agree on that.
I mean, the stacks aren't the, like, you can't abuse the Axe Winter Wyvern as well as you could when you could stack every minute, but it's still possible to do some things with that.
Well, even just playing aggressive creep, like tower skipping with the Axe, like taking a lot of damage and then just using the Wyvern for the heal. You don't have to use it to jungle.
I was just thinking of like, I felt like you needed a better reason than just having Cold Embrace against Omni Slash and having that disable go through the ult. And
It's an odd pick. I feel like if you wanted that support to pair with the Axe, like you're more likely to go towards the Dazzle, which is like one of Kimo's preferred supports often. But
yeah.
There we go.
Okay.
So it's what we might have expected in game one. Might be a game late, but it might be a game saver.
I mean, that's like an immediate response to their game one draft. Like, they probably were in the team chat saying, like, we had a four position hero that could do nothing. Like, it just didn't work. Let's get Afu on a roll where he can, and a hero where he can shine. And Earth Spirit, one of his best.
Yeah, ultimately, their decision to move Slardar into the four position and Nyx as the offlane. It's like Nyx has value with a spike carapace against those heroes, but it's also like the ultimates are still going out. Like they have this uncontrollable damage, yes, and Ravage and Epicenter and in particular the Luna's ult. Those ults are still being used, and just because you can bounce back a little bit of damage and some stun onto them doesn't mean that you can win the fight. So being able to be like having a more aggressive war position that actually sets the tone, is the initiator, lets you actually start the fights that you want to, rather than what like the fourth pickup Nyx Assassin changed into more of a reactionary style of like, oh, they use their abilities and we get to be able to do this to them.
5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
You know what I want to see here for Execration? Sniper. A sniper or the lone druid that we saw earlier.
The ranged right-clicking lone druid?
No.
Yeah, the lone druid.
That's what I would want to see. Yeah. The loneliest druid?
The loneliest druid.
Yeah. I mean, he was definitely the loneliest druid in that game because his bear never survived. Because they picked up Wraith King and that Wraith King just destroys bears.
He wasn't the correct lonely druid, though.
Yeah, I would like to see a sniper as well. Haven't seen one so far this week. I want to see some more Visage.
You would.
Yeah,
we talked about it.
Slight nerf.
Yeah.
In O1.
Yeah. How if VP isn't gonna pick it, no one is.
Mm. It's true. But yeah, I don't think it's actually that good. It's pretty terrible against Axe. The birds get chewed up. And even against like the jug, it's not too great.
I think Rubick has value for WG Unity because that support combos really well with Earth Spirits. Juggernaut is also a rotating core, whether he's mid or safe lane. And being able to have a disable to start things up and pull the hero into position for your spin is quite good. And then on top of that, I think it's pretty good versus Wyvern. Most of his abilities are valuable to steal. Cold Embrace and Winter's Spirit Curse in particular.
Breaker. Yeah,
or the Spirit Breaker.
Now it's even better with the lift too against the charge.
Yeah, for sure. You want those instant disables. Hmm. At the very least, you want a disable that will stop the ultimate after the charge goes through.
10 seconds remaining.
Yeah, I love the Spirit Breaker.
What do you think we can read into the Tinker OD bans from Execration?
Target bans against Nana mostly. I mean, the Tinker and the OD, he's generally kind of that big playmaking carry for them, and that to me is these are heroes that suit his playstyle that he's played a lot of. So
Tinker in particular would be pretty good, I think, versus a style that you're gonna go for with Axe Spirit Breaker. You're looking at a lot of tank. You're going to look at a team fight that's like 15 to 25 minutes where you're very strong just naturally due to your stats. And I think they're just going to kind of smother WG Unity. So if they get like a pushing core behind this, again, I would like still like something like the Sniper because you have like two really good frontliners as well as a good frontlining ultimate out of the Winter Wyvern. I think you are able to create a lot of space for that hero. And it's a strong pusher. Similarly, SF is really good as a hard physical damage dealer. He is also one of those heroes that is quite nice with the space given to him, but he's still able to brawl if they're afraid of Juggernaut, maybe having a Blink and Earth Spear being able to close that distance. SF is a better brawler in that regard.
They make it a disruptor.
10 seconds remaining.
They want to secure their lanes a bit. Like the Rubick pick is nice and counters some of perhaps Execration's heroes more, but this is like them kind of worried about the laning stage. Like the Axe, Winter Wyvern, the kind of pressure they can put onto the offlane Disruptor is much better at dealing with.
Wow. Okay. This is starting to look quite dirty.
I thought they were going to be more in your face, but Naga Siren's still like it is a smothering pressuring hero, but it's more of like a split pushing style of smothering, like all your lanes are constantly.
It's going to be like the four heroes fight and create space for Naga, it feels like. Like they are going to be playing very aggressive and fighting a lot, I imagine, but it's to make sure that Naga gets all her items going.
It's a very solid lineup being built up by Warriors Gaming right now.
Mm.
You like this better?
Yeah, a lot.
Playing Winter Wyvern is miserable versus heroes like Timbersaw.
Yeah.
Because you're just like, every Cold Embrace, you have that hesitance where you're like, am I setting up this other hero to actually, you know, just destroy the hero that I'm trying to save? And Timbersaw is very clearly one of the best at that.
This was the hero that WG Unity beat Complexity with two games in a row at the Major. So they've gone back to this a few times when they've been in trouble and when they feel like they need to pull out a big win, so.
I remember we talked about, like, why didn't they ban the Timbersaw in the second game? Just because it was so good in game one. It's a hero that's okay at dealing with split push. He's usually got the sustain to be able to deal with Naga Siren Illusions, and he'll oftentimes have the mobility to deal with the split push, but also still be able to group up with his team in the right time.
Actually, ban TA, so they're expecting the Timber as an offlaner.
Yeah.
I don't know. You kind of want to run like a three call lineup when you are versing that Naga, so you can maybe scale bait at the late game. But I think it's also a trap where you want to perhaps go aggressive, get that offlaner who can come online with a fast blink dagger or be at kind of initiating, kind of more fast paced tempo. But
reserve time.
Do you think Execration has got to put the siren on the mid lane?
Most likely safe lane, I'd say. Well, it depends on the matchup, but I think we're mostly seeing that kind of safe lane Naga these days.
Yeah, I'd assume so as well, but. And maybe it's because of the fact that, like, Spirit Breaker Axe is most likely, you know, some sort of aggro dual lane situation. Spirit Breaker's moving around a lot, so they feel like the two heroes of Wyvern and Siren are going to be abused by a Timbersaw offlane, so they think WG Unity is going to take advantage of that.
Dire team pick.
Ursa Band, I mean, they're anticipating a Naga potentially in the mid lane. Or they worry about like the Ursa mid versus Timbersaw.
Yeah, I think that's more likely. Yeah. I think they're thinking, oh, we're putting out Timbersaw mid and mid Ursa would just destroy us.
Yeah.
10
or it's a red herring to make Expression think that.
No, because Ursa is really good here because it's not just about the matchup versus Timbersaw, but also because they have these heroes, Wyvern, Axe, as well as Naga Siren, who all push out lanes. And that's one of the weaknesses of Ursa as a core, is that he doesn't really fulfill that role for you. So because you're able to cover that split pushing, then like Ursa just feels a lot stronger because he could just run around looking for kills and doesn't have to worry about lane maintenance.
They need a burst damage hero. Like Axe blinks and calls someone, how's that hero going to die? None of these other three heroes do any damage whatsoever. So we've waited for it. So what, safe lane morph mid-jug? Or do we even see some kind of SCA-style offlane morph? It's going to be offlane Timbersaw, I guess.
Yeah, I think you were right in the first one with the jug mid. Mm. If you're Execration now, do you go like Queen of Pain even though you are against an Earth Spirit Disruptor?
Firepower to it.
I bet WG Unity thought like there was like, man, the Morphling has so much value here. Okay. His illusions of Axe and Naga Siren are both really good.
Yeah.
Really in late game.
Puck is the final pick. Very quickly, gents. Which way? Do you favor the draft?
I think Warriors Gaming got this one.
Gods?
I'm going to stick with Execration. I think the Puck pick can work for them.
Okay.
What was the... Yeah, Puck?
Puck and Axe. Naga and Axe.
Naga.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to leave with WG Unity, but I think it's a hard call.
Yeah, this tough call. Very interesting draft for game number two. And remember, Malaysian Pride is on the line for this one as we head back to our commentary team for game number two.
That's right. Game number two, WG Unity up against Execration. Who's going to come out on top? We've got AoE galore. We've got probably all the time in the world to play this game, Ben.
A lot of time. 300 GP on Puck. Looking pretty good here.
Yeah, I'm thinking this may be our first game, which cracks the 1,000 CS mark with the Naga. Or potentially Morphling. Both really good into the late game.
Or it could be an absolute bloodbath in the start as Execration smoke inside their fountain to play some wars.
I'm like, did the meta just change? Did the entire game just change?
Now that our level one is.
I know you warned
poor.
Me you were going to try and tilt me during this cast, but still. It's going too far. I was just happy to see the Earth Spirit being picked up at the very, very start. Looking for some good rotation heroes. I know the panel was also commenting on that like, that's kind of something WG was missing. And it's nice to also see a balance with that hero, not like a Coddle Disruptor, where yes, you have like an Earth Spirit as well as a Disruptor, ability to jump in, punish, as well as the ability to pull back and punish.
They were just missing the team fight. I think it's a support that offers a lot of team fight, unlike what they had last game.
We're actually tossing up too, like how we're going to go with the last pickup. Now, are you going to stand by your phrase of you can never have enough AoE control, or...
I think.
Do you feel the Puck is going to fall off? Because I know we're both leaning towards having something like the Invoker as the last pickup instead of having that Puck. So you get control, you get a little bit more late game progression and scale.
I would prefer the Invoker because I think that Puck does have issues in the later game. Like the Morphling and the Juggernaut and the Timbersaw, I think are all okay or good enough at cleaning the Naga illusions later. So if Naga's the only threat in the late game, then I think that WG is going to be in a very comfortable position.
Maybe this is also when we look to actually that late game in the Puck. So we already feel like this game's going to go for a while. We might have ourselves a blood buff. We can.
I don't think you want it to go late though if you're Execration.
Well, is it that bad? Because I know you were joking about this earlier, or maybe it was Purge who was joking about this earlier with the Puck. where you go for the 300 plus gold, so you have all the items in the world.
Oh, that was me.
That was you. Of course it was you. Who has all the money, and you go for the Dagons, you go for everything, as opposed to going for the Illusionary Orb, which is what most have been choosing to do.
I don't know, the Illusionary Orb counts a little bit strange.
Kangaroo in a bit of trouble. He's got Timber Chain, however, so he doesn't actually have the reactive armor. Actually saves his life in this case, able to Timber Chain himself away and back to his T1 tower, but regeneration is not looking good for him.
Yeah, the discussion of that 25 talent is... it's very tricky because the Illusory Orb talent, it doesn't allow you to get away without a blink, I think is the main problem. So you're still like slot starved, I would say. But with the GPM talent, you can have a blink dagger and all these like massive items like Scythe Refresher, Dagon 5 EV, which you kind of need when you get that level 25 point as a Puck.
Puck's trying to get as aggressive as he can up against Nana and Nando. That's the Earth Spirit rotations, which Nando is probably being also very apprehensive about. He doesn't have his orb, but he face shifts, dodges the rolling boulder forward.
I think Puck's one of the best heroes mid against Earth Spirit Room. I think Juggernaut's also pretty good, but he's on the other side. So I think that's kind of one of the reasons why you would definitely prefer a Puck over the Invoker is for the laning phase, especially if you want to concentrate on zoning out the offlaner.
Well, both offlaners have been, I would say, fairly zoned out. DJ's managed to grab his second level now.
Oh, he did a pull. The Timber Saw, he was able to pull the range creep into that large camp. I think it's only possible if you get the Satyr or the Troll, but I haven't seen it too much without the use of Hutch.
But you could always use, who was it the other day? You use the Earth Spirit, and he could actually kick across.
Mm-hmm.
And this will drive the creep wave over, and that's exactly what we're like, yeah. Okay, rolling boulders to drag the creep wave in. And yeah. Yep, he gets the entire thing. So this will create a little bit of space, but also look at what Spirit Breaker got. And if his drone walks up, Afu just hit an invisible tree. So maybe the Monkey King has managed to slip his way into Captain's mode, or he understands that someone else is hanging around.
Oh, Monkey King. That hero is a lot of fun, turning into trees and couriers and whatever.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this. Jeff Clips back up on top lane, pulling DJ back in again. And he's going to go down, maybe with the extra sound. He's to time this upright, and now he will warpling waveforms in under the tower. And the kill goes the way of WG. Arjit, not a healthy man. In fact, Wyvern just splitting his damage between the two, but they go again on bottom lane now. Timbersaw with the whirling death and just chain back. Doesn't allow them to keep the aggression going instead of chaining forward into Gabby. Well, as the SP, they just let him go.
Yeah, without the Winter Wyvern there, there is no range presence on Execration's safe lane, which allows Timbersaw, despite having no reactive armor, to kind of do whatever he wants. Mid lane looks, what, fairly even. Juggernaut is 18 over to the Puck, but that's with some Earth Spirit interference.
Yeah, almost every single lane is neck and neck. Not that much between it. Wyvern might be happy, he can at least soak up a little bit of the levels up on top lane.
He's not happy that he had to come up here, though.
No, he's not. This changes the mechanic at the bottom lane. Like, it's normally a Spirit Breaker is meant to be the one rotating around and causing issues. But this Spirit Breaker doesn't actually have the support of someone like a Darkseer with Iron Shells.
That role was to pull these creeps, but the creep wave didn't die in time. That definitely helped out the Timbersaw, that one wave going to the Satyrs.
DJ is getting harassed once again. Arjit trying to get up his face. At least manages to get the Arctic Bird onto cooldown and keep the Wyvern's presence on top lane. A double damage room for the Earth Spirit. Up against Spirit Breaker, he knows he won't find a kill, and in fact, Spirit Breaker just charges away.
Yeah, unfortunately, on the top lane, the Winter Wyvern's not really doing that much. With the despite all this harass, he already has a ring of health because he got that early kill. So they are wasting a lot of effort, I think, trying to limit this Morphling's farm.
Having the ring of health, the tankers, plus any one charges, any harassment you do through Splinter Blast just boosts up the morph.
I think normally it'd be a pretty good play because there's no shrine up here, but it's really tough for them now.
Spirit Breaker trying at least to intimidate Earth Spirit out of this lane.
It's a neutral party down here.
Yeah. Gabby's gonna be pretty good at getting rid of that if he doesn't get locked in, and now Wall tried to dodge it, and not possible! The kick was perfect from Arthur, the mirror images came out, but it didn't cause anywhere near enough confusion.
It's very rare that you see, I think you got the two heroes slow, two hero roll. It's kind of like a clockwork hookshot. It's very difficult to actually stun more than one person unless they're like right on top of each other.
Now, did he hit the mark?
Yep.
That's a nice start for WG. They're already one game down. Would love to see this game go into a third. So being up 2-0, it's not the end of the world for Execration. They are about 1,300 gold behind. Only about 600 experience, but that's for a game only 5 minutes in.
I think this game they still have a stronger team fight, just like last game. So losing laning phase is not the worst thing in the world for them. I'm just worried about their later game. Last game they had a Luna to fall back on in case it goes super late. And I think this game the Naga is going to be simply outclassed by the late game.
They're going to go again on the Naga. The kick is both from Afu. And Kangaroo's just going to time this right with the chain forward. And, well, is he actually going to get the hit in? No, he doesn't. Both Whirling Death and Chain miss the target. And Winter Wyvern has TP'd in while up on top lane, the Axe dying underneath the tier 1 tower.
The Naga's still under a lot of pressure though. She was able to get some sort of creeps, but if you look at her quick buy, it's energy booster and she take her relic radiance. She doesn't want to like really buy a bottle.
Oh, Nana! Oh, he jumped back up again!
Wow.
The first two hits went onto the real Naga. It looked like he was almost out of range to jump back onto those illusions.
Jeez. Poor Naga. Like right now, the supports kind of don't know what to do right now. Like Axe is constantly dying at the top lane, he just gets glimpsed back, and the Morphling's been fed a couple of kills already. Naga Siren is like, please, I need some help down here because the Timbersaw's just up in my face all the time. She can't farm in the lane at all.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's up on the Puck. The Puck has to perhaps start moving around, maybe get Winter Wyvern to land, because Winter Wyvern isn't really able to help people or kill people. So I think he gets his level 6, and then Nando, maybe he's waiting for a kill rune, but it's still at least a minute until the next rune spawn, and he's not even guaranteed to get a kill rune then.
Because he rotates around and it's like, okay, so where is your kill potential? SB and Wyvern are control. Puck jumps in and goes for a dream call, but now he's being the one being jumped.
Yeah, it's all on the Puck, let's see.
Oh, he's actually gonna dream call up. Just kill off Arthur with the ult damage, he'll die! The dream call trigger, that'll do the work. Charge forward, actually missing Nana, it went into the siege creep instead. But Nando read it perfectly.
Yep, exactly what they need. They need to keep these Morphling from farming, or at least pressure up for other members.
Wyvern going into the Arctic Burn, does he want to fly over the tree line and get away from this Timber? Because Timber may feel confident to dive into the tower, pulls back that Sharkroom. He misses on the chain, but still hits with a Whirling Death, the last punch. And Gabby is there way too late, and they start fighting again up on top lane. 2-1-2. But technically it's a 2.5-on-2 because it's pinned! Okay, that's a little... Alright. The Axe replicant spun so much that Axe was forced out of the lane and abandoned the Spirit Breaker.
What a disaster up here though. Everyone just keeps on dying and feeding this lane.
Now they're gonna go on bottom lane with a Shaft 4. They just go in. Chakram to the chain. And this Earth Spirit Control is doing serious lifting.
Execration aren't even playing pretty well against the Timberzone. Like, they're like not moving very predictably around the trees. But look, they have so many good Timberzone players. It's kind of a question as to whether or not it should be Van versus them.
That's a warp tree soon.
Yeah, there's
Kangaroo is making sure there is nowhere to hide behind that tier 1 tower. And Spirit Breaker will show himself again, but where is his TP? Where is his control? That tier 1 tower is almost down and Spirit Breaker hasn't left yet.
The Spirit Breaker is kind of just destined.
He's charging
failure,
forward.
Say. Like,
okay.
there's not really a good hero that he can charge into. Like Juggernaut can spin, Timbersaw will just destroy him, and then the Earth Spirit can also just stun him anytime in a team fight. Like there's not really a good target for him to constantly go on. So he, I guess, has to maybe follow up after that Axe charge or maybe provide some vision. It's not going to be the typical just run at you, Spirit Breaker, or else he's going to give far too many kills.
Right now he's running towards the mid. Okay, well this is now more mana being burned.
Radiant's
every time.
Middle tower.
I suppose he got a little bit up his sleeve, but charging for a grand total of 400, 500 units.
Yeah, need some more experience. Trying to get those talents up later.
Maybe that's also the reason why, like, having Puck now with this Veil up on him, he's got at least some level of control against the Timbersaw when the jump comes in, so that's that lane switch up.
Yeah.
You're asking for the WG reads it too, so Nana as well as Xnova will move over. They find Gabby, or I can say Gabby finds them on the bottom lane. Well, you actually get the kill from the Puck, so he's done the work. Typical gets hit by the Dream Call, but the Storm is in. Do they have enough control? Puck, he's got nowhere to go, or does he? As we have a bit of hang.
Yep.
Issues.
So he has 5 stick charges on the Spirit Breaker. I'm not sure if he's going to be able to go out. Well. game's unpausing.
We'll find out. So back into the game now. Kangaroo is looking for that target, chaining forward with a Chakram out. Spirit Breaker already used his stick charge, and the Chakram just like lasts so long. But it's WG that finds more kills on the bottom lane, even though the movement from Puck did at least get them one.
They get slowly squeezed out though. It's like Naga is like her camps are limited to like maybe four camps now. Like that T1 on the bottom is already taken out, and Timbersaw occupied bottom lane. Naga cannot farm in lane versus the Timbersaw. So the Veil build too, I think Veil would be typically be pretty good, but they don't actually have that much magic damage on their team. I guess maybe a little bit from like Winter Wyvern, but there's no like huge magic burst just from the Puck alone. Axe is almost no magic damage. But I guess it will get them in kill range, and it is very useful versus a Timbersaw, which you want primarily magic damage to take down.
Yeah.
You just create that space for the Naga. You see Gabby's quick fire, he wants to go directly in to the Radiance. So I say directly with Arcanes. But
they're dewarding bottom, but they don't actually want to show, it seems.
Oh, they're waiting for a target to come out to mid. Someone to try and fight WG, but WG, they're not giving anyone, it's just that range from the Winter Wyvern. Might want to get to Artifer in a second. The Orb comes forward. Puck will not actually jump himself in just yet. Nana in very, very deep. Winter Wyvern got glimpsed back into the fight. Now that Dream Call hitting on the Disruptor as well as Timber. But there's no follow-up. If you want to Orb through the wave, they just survive a little bit longer. The fortification already getting triggered. That's because Arjit is pressuring the top lane, and DJ is stuck up here too. So the mid tower, they roll forward, they get the silence off, and Nando, he's got nowhere to go, or maybe he does with the Orb out. No, he can't. The Storm, way too good from X Nova.
They need more bodies at this fight. WG are only four strong. Morphling hasn't been in any of these fights. He has not left the lane yet. But Execration just constantly
hit. They go. Chuck forward in towards Nana, but then holds Axe. The curse will be in there too, so Timbersaw has to stick around for the moment. Nana doesn't care. He just spunked through and found himself a kill. Afu with a roll forward, and he needs to take a quick kick if he can get into the Spirit Breaker. No, he doesn't get the mana for it, but with a chain forward, it won't matter. Kangaroo.
That was supposed to be their big team fight ultimate with the first use of the Winter's Curse, but all it did was keep the Timber in place. I mean, the Timber doesn't really attack anyways, and Juggernaut was spinning, so it didn't actually have any effect. And WG, they had a healing ward earlier, now it's a shrine, there is just no downtime. And meanwhile, this Morphling Primal is going to explode quite soon. He already has Lincoln and a Ghost Scepter. Like, he is extremely rich for 13 minutes. He's just been free farming tough the whole time.
He's got 7.4k net worth. Like 13 minutes into this game.
Yeah, they're gonna have to start worrying about shotgun soon. Even if Naga gets the Radiance, Replicate is gonna come out and you can just use that for your own advantage. So they are going to have to pull out.
Rolling ball forward once again, Afu, the perfect stance. He can keep that control, however. Onto Nando with a glimpse. Do they actually have another grind back? No, not for now. Timbersaw just wants to back out, taking a little bit too much damage from the Slither Blast. But they came here for the tower, and that's exactly what they're going to get. DJ, well, he might have an opportunity. No, he goes for the call, but misses the target. Now Nana starts on his spin. Puck, Orb is up with a quick jaunt away. Gets back in range of the tier 2 tower, but Afri wants to fight once more.
But they need to keep waiting and waiting and waiting. They don't even have the arcane boost on a Winter Wyvern to stall the push out. They don't have the blink dagger on the axe. They don't have the radiance.
Losing tier 2 tower in bottom lane. Arjit's having the time of his life down here. And if you want to send the Axe 4 to be happy with that, he almost killed DJ with himself.
Yeah, maybe they can set up with like a Puck Coil or like a Winter's Curse into something big, but that requires WG to group up. I think Morphling's like particularly good versus Execration's lineup because he can kind of just run to the backside and all they have is AoE control. They don't really have single target control for the Morphling. It's not like you want to blow a Winter's Curse on the Morphling who's on the backline or a Dream Coil because he can easily wake one out of that. But at the same time, if you leave him alone, he's just going to crush your entire team in just two jumps of support with the shotgun.
Okay, Morphling just waveforms in. He wants to fight the Chakram, actually destroying the tree line, revealing the Winter Wyvern. But I just got this, so he is feeling so confident. And then when you get the glimpse back, Winter Wyvern, he's down, even the stun connected to the Spirit Breaker. He'll charge up north and then cancel it. Now Spirit Breaker, we don't have a way away. The Shark is back on cooldown. This will be your extra slow. Look for the kick coming in from Armfu. The call will do a little bit of work, but the E-play pop, will it be enough? I think the ghost is pop. Nope. Looks him back in. Axe back into the fight. Unwillingly returned to WG's hands. And WG, 14 minutes in, put their first foot inside Execration space. You go for the Nether Strike and Timbersaw. That's a big kill to get. A big one as well because the Puck was the one to claim it. almost 600 gold, 550-ish for it.
At Tempestod, I don't think he had any of the items on him. If he had his Hood of Defiance, maybe he would have been able to survive that fight, but his items actually in his inventory are bare bones. So that'll be the first big kill they take in a while. Finally, Naga will be happy with that, still looking at another 2,000 gold until that Radiance.
Radiance seems like an eternity at this point. Attack.
It really is, because everyone needs their farm. Axe is still sitting at 1,200 gold because he's been glimpsed back multiple times. And he wasn't even involved in the early fights, so perhaps if he were there to defend that T1 tower, things would have been a little bit better for them. I think Naga strategies are particularly difficult to play just because of the constant siege that your opponent puts on with the addition of the Shrine. I think it's much weaker than last patch.
When you look for the Song of the Siren to almost be your aggressive setup where you have someone like a Disruptor to pull off, not a Wyvern to follow up.
They don't have any instant cast to maybe like Spearbreaker charge through, but that is so extremely difficult to coordinate because you can't charge on vulnerable heroes. So
yeah, you need to target the back line.
Yeah, there's cast point on Call, there's cast point on Winter Wyvern spells. Coil perhaps will be okay, but nothing like Spin will just be King or Waveform or Ghost up
there. TJ's finally finding that space up on top when he's close to the Blink Dagger, but then so is Arjun. Just TP's up, he can replicate back into this fight what he wants to. The charge comes forward onto the Timber Soul. Heavy with a couple of loops through the rear, but it's in the front line. Spirit Breaker losing so much life. Radiance middle. It doesn't even look like WG is breaking a sweat to find these kills. They're just coming towards them.
Yeah, every glimpse has been spot on from X-Nova. The Destructor has just set up so many kills for them. I think normally, like, with this lineup versus, like, any other support...
Keyblade pops up, flips him back, put him into a wall, he starts off with a call, starts actually a TP, but he'd have to try his air, and TJ gets obliterated. Maybe now Nando feels like he can take a fight, but he has to jaunt back up again. Arfu's the neighborhood. Fernando's making a break for the side chop. Not exactly where he needs to be, however, because the push from WG is coming to the tier 2 tower on top.
Such a sad game for the Axe. Yeah, he just can't do anything. This is just not his game.
Yep. Oh, luckily they have one in the bag. They can try and follow up and get maybe in the third Radiant's game get something back, but at the moment, even the puck Radiant's with the Blink Dagger as well as having that Veil, he doesn't do anything against the Timbersaw, who's able to finish up a Hood of Defiance. He picked up a pipe as well for the rest of his team. They're looking even better. I think WG's actually looking fantastic anyway, just because they've got such great progression through farm and levels.
Yep, and now they'll start working on the shrines to try and close them out. So the only win possible for Execution is if the Radiance Naga is a big problem for them. So
she can't even get out there to pick up a relic. She'd have to go to the Dire Shop to pick up her relic.
That's what they need. That's the only thing that will slow them down, push out the lane so they can get some farm and get a little breathing room so WG will split up and perhaps they can get a call into a kill with the Axe, who may eventually get his Blink Dagger. But that's kind of their only avenue of winning at this point.
Timber, is he going to find Gabby? Gabby doesn't have that TP scroll to get out of here, and he's actually going to Song of the Siren.
He has no mana.
That's a problem. He needs a little bit more mana. He needs 75, but now he has it. Starts his TP out. Song of the Siren will give him just enough cover fire. Afu won't get there in time.
That was probably blessing in disguise that he didn't have any mana. I think he might have just been stunned by the Earth Spirit right then.
But that Song of the Siren now on cooldown for 100 seconds, and already WG, they were thinking about Roshan. I don't know if they'll actually continue to think about it. Without the Song of the Siren, there's very little ways that Execration can contest them.
And they can make quick work of it with Timbersaw tanking, with the reactive and the healing ward to top them all off. So,
Yeah, but they're not doing it. They group everyone down on bottom lane. Nando's starting to play more like that little maneuvering Mirana's we've seen. Creep skipping it out. Just trying to keep that momentum going the way of Execration on the lanes.
It's really hard though versus Glimpse. Like, Glimpse will punish you so easily if you make one misstep.
That's why you're supposed to fight from inside the tree line, getting in behind the tier 1, tier 2 towers.
So finally they will have the Radiance. It is flying out to Gabby as we speak.
Okay, you just picked up two blinks. One's on the Axe, and one's on the Earth Spirit. So this is the 3 versus 4 right now. And they both have that jump initiating item.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, with no song, this Roshan's no contest.
Yeah. All Execration can do is just keep them pushed. That's all. Keep the farm going. Like, you at least have the Radiance done. And Gabby now needs to start working towards BTs and turn this into a real split-push game. But WG, how do you actually approach it? You've taken out all the tier 2 towers. Can you actually go against Execration's high ground? You're 20 minutes in, do they have enough?
What?
They don't really have enough. Everything is just a flat plane for them.
Their defense is not very strong. Like, Puck spam is a little bit annoying, Splinter Blast is a little bit annoying, but I think, like, Morphling can kill almost anyone with his shotgun.
Oh, DJ gonna jump in, he needs some really good spins. Actually, he's glimpsed in, and then gets glimpsed back. He tried to do the TP, getting a little bit cute up on the top, and now in comes Morphling and just explodes him.
If they just present kills like that, then it should be an easy task for them to push high ground.
I'm wondering why he jumped in cold and TP'd out.
He wanted to kill the creep wave.
And that was all? Like, okay.
You're grasping for straws here for Execration.
So you just try and play the extra efficiency game. Get as much as you can if you get it. If you got more to fight with. It would have brought him closer towards that blade melee he's been, like, looking for as his second item.
He did buy his robe, I believe, before he died, so. Could have been worse. And he'll be up. He's
lower. Jump forward. Deeply pop. Almost enough to kill the Wyvern. Removing 900 almost.
That'll teach him to go any bit of strength.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Just had a little bit more. Blast cannon morph style.
He has Aegis and Lingus. I don't think it's the worst thing in the world, but at the same time, if you get called in silence, you're just gonna die.
They managed to at least trigger the Lincoln. They keep using Battle Hunger to do this most of the time. Now DJ, there's your blink call, pulling down Morphling. He's still got the replica to jump out to, so he doesn't really care that much. Take the damage, you've got the Aegis the Immortal. The silence is out from the puck, but the Rack is slow to be brought down, maybe with a curse. Timberstorm taking some damage, they get the call off. Three men inside that one with the Dreamform, and the Storm is up, and Execration is trapped inside the disruptor, but they reset. Song of the Siren from Gabby will allow this to happen. Tricks are trying, get a little bit of regeneration, as Glimpsing will bring back the Spirit Breaker, almost a full Omni Slash onto that SP. They're losing too many heroes, none of them with buyback. It's just a puck as well as a Naga, as WG are claiming this top Rack.
And with the healing ward, I don't even think they can get any kills off this. That's just three heroes, not even the Aegis taken down, and Rex. That was kind of all they had.
Oh no, Nando, the glimpse is pulling him all the way back in. He tried to get cute again with another quick silence, but he'll lose his life 50 seconds without the puck. You've brought down the melee, and now you've got a bigger window of opportunity. They're looking at the tier 3 tower in mid. Raindrack is mopped up by Nana. And this is two lanes.
It's pretty much it at this point.
Yeah,
they're just waiting for one more kill.
Yeah, on the side of WG. If the dream is a reality, will it actually end in 3-2-2?
Yeah, there's a Dezo. They could just end the game right now. They used all their ultimates with that last fight.
Yep. A lot to work with. Axe. Jump forward, just trying to pull the Morphling in rip, but he's still got the Aegis. If you do find that opportunity, you're not really going to get much for it. So DJ E-Blade, there's your pop. A quick jump back out to the Replicant. Instead, you go the Juggernaut, they push it back in, but now with the Chakra, Spirit Breaker losing life too quickly, or maybe not. Morphling is killing off the Earth Spirit. That's how you actually find damage Execration. You use WG to do it, but it really is only going to last for so much longer. Arjit, double kill for him. They're just falling like flies now. Morphling, maybe now with Nana spinning away. No, Morphling's still got too much strength. He's still got the Aegis. Nana lives on 44 HP. Doesn't have a healing ward available to trigger off the Aegis. Makes the Naga illusions that came out. And WG will back out. They've still brought down the melee Rack as well as all of top lane, so it's still a huge win for WG.
I like the body block from X-Nova there. He kind of saved Juggernaut. Juggernaut's already pretty fast. I don't think he would have died, but still ensured his safety. Ooh, Arcane Rune. Arcane Rune plus Healing Ward is pretty nice.
Skadi is almost, not almost, is completed.
Yeah, he's just a monster.
17,600 net worth, 24 minutes in.
The one that, if you're a support, you see him, you know he's dead.
He's going at 722 gold per minute, and this may be increased a little bit because they've found At least the real puck. The quick yule steps up, they ship all the way, they keep chasing. WG, they're just so maneuverable. Even Storm being committed by X Nova. They really want this puck. And then, well, blink down to the tree line. Nando, run to the tree line for the TPR. Rolling ball to forward. There's the stun, it's not there. Puck, he's all the way home.
Oh, I'm surprised he went for the Thunderstrike there. Instead of the glimpse. He actually got the Thunderstrike off before he TP'd out. Regardless. They're in there.
Yep. WG attacking into the tier 3 tower now on bottom. They've got double the Juggernaut thanks to the Morphling. And Nando jumps in. There's your glimpse. They're pulling it back again. A quick Yule Scepter up. Wyvern, where is the Song of the Siren? It's coming off, but you've already brought down the tier 3 tower. Nando just wants to escape back out of the wall. He has the Yule Scepter, but he's up for too long. He won't jump down. DJ, Elise has the call. Over on the Morphling. Can they kill him? They need to kill him. The Wyvern curves it out with a Splinter Blast of damage. Hits it! It doesn't make this! They just survive tank recall into the Omni Slash, rip him through at the spin. DJ will keep the call up, but he'll get sliced in two by the Tindasaur. Kick it through, stopping the Spirit Breaker, and it's GG. It was GG a while ago, but finally, they have admitted the defeat. We are going to a third game as WG will take game 2, 27-4, against Execration.
Not really sure what they were going for with the Naga there. It was very difficult to set up any.